As always, the show is never complete without sharing with you what the latest is in sports across the continent. And this morning we have the ever-dazzling Onye Obaro joining us. Good morning, Onye.
Good morning, Osa. Good morning, Olive. How's the weekend?
Mine was good. How's your weekend?
Fantastic. I had a lot of sporting actions I had to follow up with, and they were really exciting because when it gets to when Africans clinch, you know, podium finish or get a world record, of course you celebrate. So it was a celebrating mood for me all through the weekend.
And I hear it's also a celebratory mood for the people of Kenya.
Yes, it is. But it's mixed feelings there. Not a good one for them in the 100 meters, but maybe a good one for the long distance races. So great one for them there.
All right, let's hear what's happening in the world of sports.
All right, in the world of sport, we have the World Athletics Championship ongoing in Eugene, Oregon, and we've got mixed results for Africans who had their showings in the weekend. For Kenya clinched the first medal in the 18th edition of the World Athletics Championship in Oregon, USA, after Hellen Obiri and Margaret Chelimo won silver and bronze, respectively, in the women's 10,000 meters final. Both athletes finished behind winner Ethiopia's Letesenbet Gidey, who had overcome the Kenyan twin attack to emerge victorious. Meanwhile, it was a rough patch for Africa's fastest man, Ferdinand Omanyala from Kenya, who finished fifth in the third semi-final of the men's 100 meters and did not progress to the final. Ghanaian's duo of Benjamin Azamati and Joseph Paul Lemoire also failed to make the list of athletes to qualify to the semi-final of the men's 100 meters. Azamati finished fourth in heat six, where he ran alongside with Olympic champion André de Grasse, world record holder Botswana teenager Letsisele Tibogo broke the world under 20 record after a slamming performance in the first round of the men's 100 meters. Tibogo, running head-to-head, goes 5 of 7, steamed into the lead early in the race and included veterans like South Africa's Simbine Akerni. Now, Nigerian athletes competing at the World Athletics Championship in Oregon did not lower their guards despite narrowly missing podium appearance in the 4x400 mixed relays, the women hammer throw, and the men's 100 meters event. Now, of course, to keep us abreast and give us analysis of what's really ongoing there in the World Athletics Championship is Olympian, Nigerian 4x400 meters relays Olympian, ENEFIOK UDO-OBONG. Thank you, Olympian, for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
Always a pleasure to have you on our show. Now, of course, the World Championship kicked off with visa troubles. Now, for the African athletes getting into USA. Now, but with all this, the World Athletics Federation did say that they were working on plans to make sure that those visa hurdles have been stopped and would never happen again. But has this in any way highlighted the visa problems faced by Africans generally when they have to enter the USA?
Well, not just the USA. You spoke about Kenyan Omanyala, and he was a favorite to enter the 100 meters finals, but he had visa issues, and he made it public. And it's only when it went public that the authorities heeded to his application and granted him a visa. Mm. He arrived just a couple of hours before his race, and you know, with 36 hours flight, with the jet lag and everything, he just couldn't perform at his best. So it's something that it's sad because it's only affecting African athletes majorly. Africans have a way of going through stringent visa processes, not just to the US, to other European countries too. And it affects every time our participation in international competitions, it affects our participation in global immigration and customs in the respective countries. So it's a big problem that should be challenged, but it should be one of the criteria for hosting major championships. If you cannot have an ease of visa process, I don't think you should be hosting the world.
Okay, you talked about Africa's fastest man, Ferdinand Omanyala. Now, he got into his US visa 24 hours before his race. A flight from Kenya to Oregon is 18 hours plus. He had 3 hours after landing to clear customs, to get to the arena, to pick accreditation, to warm up, to also compete with well-rested athletes, other well-rested athletes. What has this exposed on the African scene?
Yeah, just like I said, and maybe I should use a little bit of experience to make the viewers understand more the process. Mm. You see, when you go to run, it's not a situation of going to the stadium and going to pick up your tag or whatever and going to run. Mm. Between the time in which you are called to run your race and the time on which you compete. Sometimes a 3-4 hour period. You have the first call, you go through a lot of clearance. You have the second call, you got the third call, which is only about 20 minutes before the race. Then you have the final call, and then you go through a lot of process and checks before you're even allowed to go into the arena to run. So it's a long process, which also includes, which you should also add your warm-up preparation period, your other pre-race period. So on a personal note, when I had to run in the Olympics, I go to the arena 6 hours before the race to prepare myself and to prepare all the race formalities before I run. Now, for an athlete to just land the country 3 hours before the race, he has a lot of process. He first of all has to pass immigration. He first of all has to go and get accreditation, which obviously may take another 15, 20 minutes, depending on how many people are there for the accreditation. Then he has to go through his warm-up process, then he has to go through every process. And within this time, mentally, you're already confused that you are late. And this affects you totally. So when you hear that he arrived 3 hours before the race, it's not just that you had 3 hours to even come in. There are lots of things that you have to do, because when you are at the venue, you normally go about 3 or 4 hours before the race. So it totally destabilizes him, and it's unfortunate that such a thing will happen at a big championship. So it exposes a lot of things, a lot of problems that is wrong with hosting a competition when you have not done all the other checks. Most European countries are visa-free to the US, so they will just go without problem. Some of them have very easy online visa processes, but I don't know why it's very difficult in African countries. We always have very strict processes. Even in, we are affected in Nigeria, we've been talking about the Manyala. We're very lucky one, because the Nigerian team was very critical. They couldn't get visas. So they were critical in making sure that they put in people that were either living in America or already had visas to the US. And that's why our team probably in some cases were not strong enough. Many of our coaches, a few of our coaches couldn't go because they didn't have the visas. Applying for the visas, they gave them an appointment date of 2024. I mean, that's incredible. We're in 2022, the tournament is here. You're giving them an appointment date in 2 years later. That's a big issue, that's a big problem. So it's something that the American embassy has to look at, something that the authorities have to look at, because this encourages lots of touting, lots of big visa racketeering, and also destabilizes the country that's actually preparing for the competition.
Okay, Annie, you've been there, you've done that before. And with the fact that you have been there, you've done that, how best do you think athletes who are in this kind of situation, because we know that other world championships would likely see things like this, how best do you think they should handle situations like this?
Well, I could suggest lots of ways, but unfortunately, it's not the athletes' point to handle. It's the organizers to make sure that this doesn't happen. When you give a hosting rights to a country, you tell them that they must work with countries, but start preparing their athletes early for the visas and make sure that those things don't happen again.
Okay. Now, at this year's championship, in 2017, before this year, let me run back through memory lane right now. Only three African male athletes made it to the semi-final of the 100 meters at the World Athletics Championship held in London. Now, this year, seven African men were in the semis of the men's 100 meters race. Now, the number has now increased by a double figure in 5 years. Do you think African sprinting is on the rise with the fact that we are seeing more Africans quarter in the 100 meters, the likes of Raymond Ekevo, Ferdinand Omanyala, Azamati, who could not even make it to the semis there. But we're seeing Lesile Tibogo from Botswana. Has this given us a reason to say that African sprinting is on the rise?
Yeah, African sprinting is on the rise. African sprint is on the rise. And that's actually the truth. We've always been on the rise. We've always been at par. Well, we've seen in the past the Nigerian sprinters are always with the Americans or the Jamaicans, but now we have more African sprinters that are from more countries, from the Cote d'Ivoire, from Ghana, from South Africa, from Botswana, from Kenya, and that shows that African sports is on the rise. Unfortunately, especially as Nigeria, we have to put our acts up and we have to improve so that they don't rise and get us. While the African sprinters are coming up, we should also be going higher to keep up with the American and the Jamaican. And that's just really what's happening within the sprinting situation in Africa.
Okay, great one. So what's your take concerning the exclusion of Ezinne Aba just 40 minutes before she could pick a flight to Oregon and also Alaba Akintola from the Nigerian team?
I think that's a poorly publicized or poorly interpreted thing by the media. Ezinne Aba was not included in the team. She was eligible to run, but hadn't been in the team for different reasons. The first thing is that she didn't even run the trials in the selection trials in Benin. So she was no how that she could have been selected to the team. And even they wanted to bring her as a substitute, which was initially the plan. She hadn't fulfilled all her out of competition tests. And you can remember last year we had problems in the Olympics for out of competition tests. So it hadn't been fulfilled. So she couldn't legitimately have competed. So people didn't understand it, and Ezinne too probably misrepresented herself while she went on social media to do that. The Federation have been in contact with her, and I'm very sure that the explanation has been very clear to her.
Thank you so much for giving us clarity on that. Of course, that's ENEFIOK. I need to tell me how to pronounce that name right now because it keeps clicking in my tongues. So let me get the real pronunciation. All right, you want me to call you Annie, and that's what I normally call you. So, Annie, thank you so much for joining us today on Breakfast Sport. We do appreciate your contribution.
Thank you. You're welcome.
All right, that's updates there, of course, from one who has been there, who has done that. He won gold medal in Sydney 2000 for Nigeria, running the 4x400 meters relays there, ENEFIOK UDO-OBONG. Of course, giving us clarity on what happened in the Nigerian Athletics Federation about Ezinne Aba and Akintola Alaba. So, sport updates for you, Osa Olive. Over to you.
All right, very interesting there. But I mean, from your perspective, what do you think might be going on with these visa issues? You know, and with our athletes always having these challenges every time there is some international place to represent their countries.
There is always a hidden truth there when it comes to preparation by federations for their athletes to represent the country. Now, news made the rounds, especially for Kenya, that some fun-loving fans made their way to the US in Oregon just to go support Kenya without putting top priority to the athletes. Omanyala got to the Oregon World Athletics very late for his championship, and that's a failing coming from either the Kenyan Sport Ministry or the Kenyan Athletics Federation. But generally, we cannot overlook the fact that a lot of Africans have issues to get into other countries. You know the whole thing, the whole tag about Africans getting into other countries. But people would also blame the World Athletics for not preparing this ahead of time to know that these athletes have been accredited, these athletes have been given the go-ahead to attend this championship. So they shouldn't have any hustle getting into the US where the championship is being held.
I think another angle would be the amount of regard you place on yourself would be the amount of regard that an external person would place on you. Even within Africa, it's very difficult a lot of the time to cross from one African country to another African country. There are a number of them. And we're still having these kind of conversations, of course, where they see that there's even no regard for your passport within your continent. How do you expect someone outside your continent to give your passport that same regard that you desire, that you cannot get within your continent? We have a lot of work to do.
Yes, a lot of work to do, but the World Athletics know that this accreditation given to the athletes should be a pass that they have been cleared to go for the championship in the US. So it shouldn't have been
really
a
problem.
It's really
heartbreaking because these countries, these African countries, have some of the best talents, you know, in athletics across the whole world.
Yeah.
And so, you know, the times when they really should have a really smooth pass, you know, to go and display these talents, we shouldn't be having these types of conversations. It's heartbreaking. Every now and then you hear about some African athletes, changing nationality, going to run for Belgium or run for,
also,
for the Netherlands.
I would surprise you. A lot of Africans, Adeleke ran for the Netherlands. A lot of Africans, Mew also is running for the US. They're all Africans. Stefan Hassan is running for the Netherlands. So you can see for sure that Africans, there's a lot of poaching going on because they're not being celebrated in their own country.
We need to make sporting look more attractive, rewarding, and respectful for athletes within our continent. Mm. That way we can keep them here. We can get them to run for us. We can get them to represent us as opposed to them, you know, going outside the continent. But there's a lot of work that needs to be done. I'm glad that we're highlighting these conversations. It's always a delight to have you, Oyinyo Barrow, join us.
Thank you so much for having me.
All right. Do enjoy the rest of your morning.
Thank you.
Now, in case you watching are just tuning in,